bring up a calculator on a touch-sensitive display that was beside you was, again, just so, it was so vulnerable. People would say, yeah, come on, you can buy a calculator for, you know, very, very little amount of money to bring it up on this multi-million dollar computer with display on the right and left was totally ridiculous. Well, it wasn't, and later versions of it, you know, where we made the room even more elegant and, you know, with speech recognition and gesture recognition, was, to be honest with you, the beginning of the Media Lab. And I'll tell you why. I don't know if this is published in too many places. I've said it three or four times in my life. It turns out that this lab, which was an area about twice the size of this room, so it wasn't a huge lab, but that included the offices and the lab space and so on, happened to be the top of a building whose elevator the president of MIT used to go to lunch and meet his chauffeur. And the then president, Jerry Wiesner, was the last president to have a chauffeur. But more importantly, he made this trajectory almost every day with his guests. And when he would take a guest to lunch, and the president takes some pretty interesting, fancy guests to lunch, he'd say, oh, there's this cool group up there doing things, and let's walk through the lab. And it's a photogenic lab, things like this up and running, displays you can touch, images. Again, this is in the 70s, so you have to appreciate how just a color display with text and picture on it in some kind of high res. We had 1,000 by 1,000 color display, sort of 2 feet by 2 feet flat. Unheard of at the time. There were 6 of them in the world. We had a flat panel display. This will amuse you. We had a flat panel display, the only one in the non-classified world that was 64 pixels by 64 pixels, black and white, with 20% of them missing because they had broken. And a little piece of glass, and people would ooh and ah at this little piece of glass long before flat displays, LCDs, any of those were made. So it was a very photogenic lab. So the president marches through with all of his friends and does this, comes back after lunch, he does it before lunch, after lunch, who knew? And so over time, over a period of about, oh, I don't know, 6, 8, 10 months, we became pretty good friends. And then he started to become interested in, you know, more than just taking his friends through it. He started to become interested because he himself was deeply interested in the arts. When he graduated, he was Lomax's science engineer in Washington just after the war, and then, you know, became involved with academic issues and administration. He was the dean, and he's a dean of science and the dean of engineering at MIT at different times. Provost Kennedy, science advisor, comes back. That's about when this is all going on, and confides in me. He says, you know, I'm going to step down as president, and I'm not going to become chairman, because usually the president of MIT becomes chairman, and the chairman becomes chairman emeritus, and everybody shifts up one. He said, Nicholas, I'm going to go back into research life, and I'm going to become a professor again. But there's no lab for me to work in. And I said, Jerry, I'll build one. And we'll call it the Media Lab. And he said, terrific. And so from 1980 to 82, we spent more nights with each other than we did with our respective families, and traveled around and raised the money and built, built this thing in 82, opened it in 85, and God, we thought that was modern. We thought it was modern, it was cool, it was more importantly, it was ours. It's like owning a bulldog or something, it was ours. And we loved it dearly. When we opened the Media Lab, it might amuse you that our speaker was Steve Jobs and our caterer was Martha Stewart. And I told both of them that we launched their careers. Steve was long before we had opened the building. Steve was quite active. I introduced him to Ed Land. He spent a lot of time in the old group. And in that period, he was a little bit less obstreperous than he was as he grew up, so to speak.